That might be the other thing, is that there might be lower turnout. One of the things you have talked about, George, you've said that you would like to see a Norway-style relationship with the EU. We talk a lot about the Norway option. Norway is in the European Economic Area and EFTA, the European Free Trade Agreement, an organisation that Britain was the founding member of almost 60 years ago. Take a look at this.
Church House, discussion of the European free trade idea was opened by Mr. Heathcote Emery. 15 countries, including Britain, joined in the frank discussion. As the Chancellor addressed the conference, Pathé News sought the opinion of his predecessor, Mr. Peter Thornycroft.
We're really moving out of the age of nations and into the age of continents.
Now, that was former Conservative Chancellor Peter Thornycroft there at the end of that Pathé News clip. George, why do you think that Britain should return to an organisation that it left some decades ago?
Because I think the truth at the heart of what the British people have asked for is they want to be out of the political union, but in a free trading relationship, in a single market, in a common market. Most of my constituents voted Brexit, said, George, we voted for the common market, we've ended up in a political union, we don't want it. Now, to me, there are two options. The Prime Minister's negotiated a bespoke, special deal, and it's very impressive what she's managed to achieve in lots of ways. I think the backstop is
problematic. Not everyone agrees with you on that,
I agree.
Of course,
after 2 years. For my view. Yep. I think it's very impressive that she's got it. My problem is that I think it makes us a very unilateral player, puts us in a position where if we exercise our freedoms, we undermine our union, and I'm not sure it'll hold. I think EFTA is very powerful because it is a group of sovereign, free-trading nations in a European bloc, trading in the single market, out of the customs union, free to do trade deals, and when we join it, it'll become the biggest bloc in Europe, and I think it'll send a signal. We're not leaving Europe with Putin at the gate, Trump in America, China on manoeuvres, the Middle East in flames. We are a European nation, serious about security and trade. That's why I think EFTA is a good deal.
I mean, does this not demonstrate the difficult relationship that the UK, that Britain has had with Europe for decades, since the war, basically, and before then, in terms of being in, out, semi-detached? How close should the relationship be?
I mean, precisely on EFTA, I mean, the advantage of this is precisely that it tries to have a sort of creative reimagining of that relationship with Europe. I noticed the Prime Minister this morning couldn't really put a name on a future relationship with Europe. Friends with benefits was the joke, and she didn't really seem to register on it. But it has that. I mean, the great thing about these creative moderate solutions are that perhaps in some sort of logjam situation they may work. But first of all, it can't be the Prime Minister's deal because she's locked herself into certain positions previously.
To lead the customs union.
Before the negotiations as well, and free movement's a crucial thing for her, and some manoeuvre. And secondly, crucially, it doesn't solve the Irish backstop issue, but the DUP have said they might be willing to consider some sort of EFTA-style arrangement, even though they haven't put much thought into it thus far.
I'm not keen on it, but I did want to say it kind of concentrates again on the whole relationship of the British economy being to do with trade. And this whole panic is about trade. And one of the things that's really annoying in this whole discussion is that actually trading is not what creates strong economic prosperity. Strong trading emerges when you've got strong productivity and so on. And one of the things that it was frustrating about Carney, but even this discussion, is we're not having a discussion about why the Bank of England or any big businesses who are going around scaremongering aren't investing in technology, innovation, solving the productivity problem. So one of the dangers of this discussion that happens amongst politicians, CEOs, economists and all the rest of it, is that they are actually behaving as the technocrats that people are trying to shake them out of being. I mean, that was one of the big things about the Brexit vote, was it was time for a change. We can't just keep saying the status quo is good enough. It isn't.
I think Claire makes a really interesting point. As you know, I believe we have to implement the will of the people in the EU referendum. There's a lot of different ways to do it. But crucially, we've got to tackle the domestic grievances that I think led to it, and that was about a weariness with austerity, with poor infrastructure in my patch, with local service cuts, with a sense that they were being abandoned by globalisation, low skills.
So everything the Conservative government's done then?
So, no, I think the key is to get back onto that agenda. And one of those things that's attractive about the Norway option is, guess what? It would need us to implement improvement in skills, a radical renewal of our citizenship, and be more like Norway, one of the richest countries in Europe. And I worry that if we don't have a clear economic model, we will end up with deepening anger at a political class.
It would have freedom of movement, of course, wouldn't it?
Yeah, but it's also, you've got to take into consideration politics. I mean, you know, if you look at the kind of very serious, big, problematic arguments in terms of politics in Norway and all the rest of it, you can say, oh, the economy's okay. What I'm saying is there's more to life than just the economy. And I don't mean that like I think it's fine if people are poor. What I mean is that what's happened is people are genuinely demoralised. They were told there is no alternative. People got fed up at that. And they have taken action to indicate, shake things up. So I just think trying to tinker around with it at the level of an economic puzzle game, which is the way people are treating it.
I'm more with you than you realise. I'm not a tinkerer. I'm looking for some very bold policy.
But also, no deal is not, you know, no deal is now being presented as though this is like crashing out of control. It's true that Theresa May would never have the imagination to choose it, but it could be chosen that you leave. Just say to the UK, OK, we're going, we are now going to determine this. And there'll be cost with that, but I think it presents us with more opportunity.
We should have done that 2 years ago. We should have prepared for it.
I agree.
Unfortunately, with 3 months to go, it's a bit
late. I agree, but I don't like being blackmailed. And generally speaking, the idea that we should have done it, we didn't do it, so now you've got no choice, doesn't suit the temperament of the times.
And